Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Got another game today to work on. It's actually part of that double pickup I had the other day where I got the Twin Eagle. It was one of the cabinets, and the other cabinet, of course, you saw briefly on that video. That's the one we're going to be looking at today. Figured it's time to take a peek at it. I'm kind of doing both of those at the same time. I'm doing a little bit of the Twin Eagle one, a little bit of this one. So now it's time for me to explore it. I'm curious. I mean, I bought it kind of sight unseen. It's been sitting down there in the garage for a little bit, so I think it's time to crack it open. I'm curious to see what the heck's inside and if it does indeed work. So that's the big thing, because it was supposed to. Anyway, let's head on downstairs. All right, back down into the garage. So if you've been watching my other restoration videos, namely the Twin Eagle 2, you may have noticed the Stargate machine in the background, and I mentioned it, of course, right in the beginning of that Twin Eagle video. So this one I got at the same time as the Twin Eagle, and the minute I got him home, I just put this one here. I started on the Twin Eagle because I figured that would be the easier of the two. This one has just been sitting here, literally. I haven't looked at it at all. I actually bought both of the games pretty much blinded, $100 a piece. Even the Stargate was $100. Now, I have a Defender, but I've always liked Stargate 2. I love this cabinet style. I think it's pretty cool. And Stargate is a cool game. I don't know if I'll end up keeping both Defender and Stargate, but at $100, I figured I'd give this one a shot. The reason this one was very cheap is basically, I mean, there's always going to be a catch, right? It's supposed to work, but it has, rotate it here so you can see. You notice something about it. There is no monitor. No monitor, and there's actually no, the wood in the back here. It didn't come with any at all, so it's something I'll have to fabricate. So no monitor and no back door. It's also, apparently this thing was cannibalized for some parts. So, let me just double check that you guys can see it here. Well, yeah, and I'll come in close, but the joystick is missing, and these two buttons are missing. These buttons are there and seem to be okay. Now, buttons are simple to find for this thing. Joysticks for Defender and Stargate are not easy to find, and when you do find them, they're really expensive. So, I've been proactively looking for some of these things, and I did find a Memron Club who sells these. $75 shipped. It looks stock, but it's slightly modified underneath. The ones he sells have something called, I think, a zero play kit. Supposedly the pro Defender players use those kind of joysticks because they're a lot less wiggly, better quality. So I'm going to give it a shot. So I've already bought that from him, so that I have coming. And these buttons are simple enough to find. Let's see here. As far as the monitor goes, if you're watching my Twin Eagle Restore, if you remember, I kind of went back and forth. Not the Twin Eagle, actually the Time Pilot, I should say. I kept going back and forth to the monitor types, and I had a spare 19-inch monitor I shoved in there. Then I eventually ended up putting in my 25-inch Biolabs, the brand new monitor, in there, which means I had the 19-inch monitor to spare. Or now I have it to spare, so that 19-inch monitor is going right in here. So the monitor situation is solved. The buttons are easy enough to order from anywhere else. And the joystick I have bought from somewhere else. Now, it looks like it doesn't have the coin door and the coin box door here, but he actually did include those. Now, they're probably going to be missing some parts, I guess, like the nuts and the bolts. So, this is the one that goes at the bottom. This is obviously going to need some restoration. And over here, I mean, it's just dirty, it needs some paint, but that'll work. And it's got the cabling and all that. So, those parts are included. I pretty much got to supply the bolts, I guess, unless they're hidden somewhere in here, which I'm not sure yet. And I quite literally have not looked at this machine since I got it. I just kind of shoved it in this corner and didn't touch it because I just didn't have time. So, I think it's time to finally take a look at this guy. And it's interesting, it almost looks like a partial restore. Now, let me get the camera here closer to show you what I mean. In fact, I'm going to handhold it here. Get the tripod off to the side. So I was taking a closer look at this thing, and hopefully there's not too much glare. I'm looking at the marquee. And the marquee looks fine. Now, like typical, you know, things will be dirty and all that, but what I don't like on marquees when there's paint flaking and all that kind of stuff, and there's nothing here. It's just dirty. This bezel's coming off, but whatever, I can screw that down. The marquee is actually totally fine. I come down here, look at the speaker panel. Again, I see a little bit of dirt here, but it's fine. The bezel, same kind of thing. As you can see there, lots and lots of dirt. Lower the light a little bit. But the bezel itself, and these aren't easy to find, looks to be in pretty good condition. Again, it's just dirt. If you take off the dirt here, it's pretty good. The control panel overlay
almost looks new. There's a little scuff there, but it's in amazing condition. There's no reason for me to change it, which is cool. You can see the paint on the cabinet here. Again, a little bit of dirt, but looks like it's been redone, and the same thing over here. The front, and you know, you see some scuffs where the coin door was, but that gets covered. The rest of it is all, again, great condition. I don't need to do anything. The T-molding did not come stock with yellow T-molding. This game obviously came with, I assume, black. The T-molding is in pretty good condition. Now I'll have to take it off to do my, you know, whatever restore work I do, but I can reuse it. So this almost looks like it was a partially restored game, and somewhere along the way they stopped, which is an amazing condition. So looking at it from the front, get this back on the tripod. There we go. Looking at it from the front, it's an amazing condition. I need to clean up and nothing more, and it's good to go. This thing a little crooked here. Hold up. Yeah, whatever, that'll do. Anyway, so I was kind of surprised by the condition. Like, I did buy this blind from a fellow Claw member, and I wasn't quite sure what to expect, aside from the missing monitor and missing back door. But this part looks great. Now, where it does kind of start to fall on its face a bit is on the side. So, let me spin this guy around. Just without a monitor, this way is basically nothing. This is the part that's kind of a shame. When you look at this side art here, this is actually pretty darn good. And if both sides were like this, I wouldn't do anything to it. I would have just cleaned it off and left it as a survivor. However, unfortunately, there's two problems. For one, and this will be probably hard to tell, the bottom of this cabinet is chewed up really badly. And I mean really badly. It's going to need Bondo work no matter what. But more importantly, while this side looks great, the other side, left foot, the other side is kind of shot, which really is a shame, because the other side of the cabinet looks great, but this side is just toast. So, I mean, I have two options here. The typical way is stencil it, but I think I may take another route with this one. I definitely want it to look like this, of course. I mean, it has to be painted on. I have a friend who does touch-up art and paint, and I think I may have him just correct this, or see if he can correct this, rather than me stencil the whole thing. Because, quite honestly, I suck at stenciling. If you watch my Joust video, you'll see that. So whatever this cost is for stenciling, I think stencils for this game are maybe just 80 bucks. I'm going to assume I'm going to have to buy two of them, because I'm going to screw up the first one. It's worth like 160 bucks, and my time spent for stenciling. I'm almost thinking, rather than do that, I'll just pay him to touch up all this art. Obviously, it's got to be repainted red down there and touch up all the rest. What I have to do before he can touch it up, most likely, chunk of cabinet, where the areas where the chunk of cabinet are missing, I probably have to bondo it. The bottom needs extensive bondo work. That's, there's no way around it. But other than that, just let him touch it up. I'll probably take the T-molding off first and have him do his thing. So that is an option I am entertaining for this cabinet. I mean, just to see what will happen. I mean, maybe it'll look pretty cool. I mean, part of the reason I'm thinking of that is I bought a few games from TNT Amusements, who's they restore games out east. And as far as I know, they don't re-stencil stuff. They just touch it up. And my Super Pac-Man cabinet is one of those examples. And you can watch my Super Pac-Man Let's Play video to see the quality of it. The quality of it is really, really good. It came out great, and they didn't re-stencil it. They just worked with the original art that was there. So I think that is the route I'm going to go with this one. I will not re-stencil it. I'm going to have an artist come in. I'll just pay for his time. Yes, I know it'll be a lot of money. And yes, I know it would be cheaper for me to just put a decal sticker on. But I don't like decal stickers unless it's how it originally the game originally came. I'm going to pay an artist to fix this up and see what happens. So aside from that, the game does play blind. Let me see what we have. Like I said, I don't know what to expect, because it supposedly works, but that's all I know. I have not looked at this game. We're looking at this game together the first time as well. Anything inside? All right. A couple of screws inside here. Well, I want to keep them with the coin door here. I don't know where they will go or what they would be needed for. So I can see the boards inside. That's a good sign. I can see the little connector here. Right here. I don't know if that comes up, but that goes to the coin door and is not chopped up. That's a good sign. There's not a whole lot more I can see from here. We've got to turn it around and get to the guts and stuff. Yes, I'm going to put my Teflon feet on this one like I do. Oh my goodness.
okay, so right away we see some wiring going to the marquee, still tied down, that is good. This, I don't know what's going on here. There's definitely some, this doesn't look right, something has been snipped. I don't know, we'll deal with that, and I don't really know what's going on there. Probably the first thing I'm going to do after I clean this cabinet is get my monitor in here, that 19-inch monitor. Yeah, I mean, I'm assuming it should fit in here just fine. And a couple of screws here, it'll stay in place. So that should be okay. The back door, well, let's take a look at the back here. Let me make sure I can...
I don't have a viewfinder on this little Sony, so... Or it doesn't have a little viewing monitor. I didn't bring it down here. But okay, this will be enough.
I don't see any tags or numbers or anything like that. Just a typical filth and dirt. The back will have to be painted. It looks like whoever did this partial restore started from the front and stopped. What's good is the bezel is here. That's cool, because these are hard to find. So in theory, I just slide the monitor in here and we're done with that part. Okay, well, this back thing I'm going to have to manufacture myself. It looks to be quarter inch plywood. So it's just a matter of measuring and cutting it to size, which is simple enough. As far as how that latches into place, I don't know. I mean, there's a groove here. I'll have to put a groove at the bottom so the bottom sits in here. Okay, it looks like, if I remember right, a groove at the bottom so it sits in here, and then on top of it, a key, and there's a little hole here. So that is how that can be done. I can make that. I'm not too worried about it. Now, these ones I'm familiar with because I have some other Williams machines. I have Joust, Robotron, and Defender. Williams games are such classics, I just had to have them. So this one, I know there's two latches on the inside, and this door swings up. So let's take a peek here. And one latch looks to be already open, of course. And the other latch, there we go. All right. This is where it will get interesting. Okay.
Let's see what we got here. It's, this is always the fun part for me, because I never really know what to expect on the insides of these machines, so it's a little bit of an exploratory process.
It's just always kind of cool. So let's see, I'm familiar with how the Williams games are. This is kind of the ROM board for the game. So we can see here, Stargate, ROM 1A, 4A, and so on. Let's see here. Yellow label, usually on these Williams games, they're different versions are denoted by different colors. I don't know too much about Stargate, if this is an old ROM or a new ROM, but these things are colored yellow. So this is the ROM board, this is the I.O. board, and this is their generic kind of board that all the games use, Joust will use it and so on. Now, from looking at it, I think it's an early revision board because you see this wire here and there's another wire here. They did various fixes to these boards as time went on. And the early boards, even my Robotron, I have two boards for Robotron. I have a Rev A, I believe, and then maybe a Rev C or a D. And the Rev A, or the early board, has all these little jumper fixes, and the later board does not. So I'm going to guess that this is... Well, maybe it says it right in the board. Yeah, okay, there we go. So this is a Rev B, relatively early board, but you can substitute other boards for this. This generic board, I believe, is the same in Joust and in Robotron. But what's interesting here to me, it looks like there's been some mods done. Huh. That is interesting. So over here we got, I guess there's a power board, a sound board, but okay. This looks all kind of stock. What's interesting here is, there's two things that's interesting. Normally these came with a battery compartment over here that's held, I think it was three AAA batteries. That is gone. This is not standard. This is not how these games came. So someone has modded this already and removed the battery compartment and put this little lithium. I don't know. Typically what I tend to do on my boards, when they have that old battery compartment on there,
see, can you guys see this okay? Yeah.
I'll snip it, move away completely, put in an NVRAM. And it's one of these chips around here, you gotta desocket and put in the NVRAM here. But you know what, since this has this battery mod, I'll just leave it. This is perfectly fine. There's no reason to touch this. What is very interesting to me is this right here. I've seen this before because I've installed it before. And what I believe this is part of the 5-volt RAM mod. Now, normally these guys, you saw it in my Joust, these come with RAMs that use like 12 volts. They run really hot, they get cooked, they burn and blow all the time. And you can switch it to the little kit, which will feed 5 volts to the RAM, different set of RAMs you change, the 5-volt RAMs, and you put this little kit here,
from Bob Roberts. It's just a little wiring harness that just kind of instead of sending 12 volts to the RAMs, it'll send 5. That's what this looks to be.
And if I look at the RAMs, I wonder if I can identify them.
4164. Yeah, so they're 4164 RAMs. I believe that is the 5 volt RAMs.
I can't remember what the original RAMs were, but I'll tell you. I'm pretty sure these have all been changed to be 5 volt RAMs, which would be great, because I do that on all my Williams games, and you should always do it to yours too.
So that'll save me some hassle. And the reason I think they are is, normally when they're original RAMs, because they burn out so often, you'll see all kinds of different types of RAMs here. Every one of these is exactly the same. And I believe 4164 is indeed the 5 volt RAM. I'm going to verify it later. But it looks like this board has had some work to it. It's got the 5 volt RAM kit right here and the button battery. Those are the two standard mods you always want to do on Williams games. Looks like that's been done, which is great. Now, looking at the ribbon cables, I know these ribbon cables die all the time. I had to change the I.O. one, especially this I.O. one. When this one starts to go bad, all manner of craziness happens. On my Joust, I had weird things where, like, you could be playing and it would suddenly switch control to the other side, or one controller was controlling both of the birds. Just all kinds of crazy shit will happen. I see one here is black and one is blue. I cannot remember what the original color is on these things, but I assume it would have been the same color. I mean, this seems to tell me one of these two at least has been changed, which is kind of cool. The easy way to usually tell is to look at the back of this thing and see when it's been desoldered, it'll get like discolored a little bit. I'm just double checking my viewfinder here, making sure you guys can still see everything. Yeah, I'll have to check and see which one of these has been resoldered. I'm hoping it's the I.O. board, that one tends to go bad. But let's start checking numbers too. This is a little thing I just like to do. I like to see if things are numbers matching. And there's usually, here we go. So Williams, 560147. Okay, we got a number tag here. 560147. All right, that matches. 560147. All right, these here are actually all numbers matching. Pretty cool. So let us move inside. There's a couple of other boards here. The one on top, 560147, that is a numbers matching board too. All the boards actually match. These are all original. Oh, check this out. Can you see it down there? Well, on the power supply board, 560147. Well, what the heck are the odds of that? All right, this is great. I've never seen that. Oh, wow. All right, check on the inside here too. So I'm going to take this by hand so you guys can see. 560147. So that power brick matches the power supply, which matches the soundboard, which matches the ROM board, matches the I.O. board, and matches the generic logic board. So this is a complete numbers matching Stargate. Wow. I don't think I've ever seen that before. Usually something goes bad, something gets swapped. They're never all matched up. This just doesn't happen. Wow, that is really rare. That is super cool. I kind of wish I could find a number on the cabinet. Okay, I mean, you can see over there. Let's get this guy inside here. I mean, there's a little date. It says April 5, 1982, inspected, tested. Okay, that's fine. There's a little tag in the coin door. But what I'm looking for, put this back onto the tripod. I'm trying to see if there's a number. If I could match this to the cabinet, is there any numeric tag? Let's see what we got. I can't imagine this was the original power cable. I don't know. This looks kind of a little bit ghetto, to be honest, but is there no tag? Well, I can't find any numbers on the cabinet itself. But still, nonetheless, this is kind of exciting to me because I've never had, I don't think any of my Williams cabinets are completely numbers matching. This is a first to me, which is really cool. What is this? There's something just hanging here. I don't know what the heck this is. I mean, there'll have to be some exploratory stuff done. My immediate guess, because this is a 6-pin Molex, is that this is going to be to the monitor, and it supplies RGB ground, and there should be a sync cable. So this is probably the monitor signal is what this is, most likely. So that's easy enough to connect, cool. And there should be, okay, there we go, cool. And here's the monitor power cable. So these two cables that are not attached, okay, and there's the ground cable. So let's get this guy rotated here. We have monitor ground right here, we have monitor power right here, and we have monitor video signal. Good. So that should go all to the monitor and be no problem. So the only changes I would do, everything looks to be pretty good. I love that this is numbers matching, I'm not gonna lie. So what I will probably do, this connector here, they say to change because it tends to make a poor connection. I'll probably change that one, but the rest of it, if it works, I'm gonna leave it be. Yeah, all right, very good. I'm still looking inside here. Let me get the camera off and so we can take a look inside together with me. It looks relatively clean. As you can see here, not a whole lot, just a little bit of dust to clean, not too bad. At the bottom, there is some gunk, as you can see here, not a big deal. I can clean all this. There's a fuse I'll have to test. Power. Some more screws. I tend to keep these. I'm not going to vacuum those up. So the cabinet looks pretty clean. Yeah, again, I'm hoping to find a number that would just tie this all to the boards. But I don't. So this, I forget, this is probably the rear. Does it pull out? Or, yeah, I think normally this goes to the back of the cabinet, I believe. And when the back door comes off, you know, it doesn't let the game turn on. So I don't know if this is disabled or not. I may have to hold this in when I power up the game. So I'm going to see if this game actually works. I don't know what that is. Okay. Not too bad. So, if we're lucky, what we're dealing with here is basically a whole lot of cleanup. Let's get this back onto the tripod. Yeah, if I'm lucky, we're looking at a bunch of cleanup. Installing the monitor. Let's see. Cleanup, installing the monitor, refurbing the coin doors. And having my artist friend redo the sides. And that's it. Well, I think I will paint the back. Oh, there is some weirdness at the top here. What is this? What is going on here? Okay, I don't know what this piece is, but this is coming off. Yeah. So I will have to paint the top, probably the marquee brackets, and the back. Oh, and I have to fabricate a back door. So this is not too bad. Now it's a question of, does this all work? So let's put this back on here. Just raise this one more time. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to power it up. Before I power it up, though, I'm going to probably take this power cable off here. I want to just measure voltages. I want to make sure a good 5 volts is going there. So I'm going to just go grab my multimeter really quick and measure some voltage. Okay, I've got my multimeter in place. I've taken the power cable off, as you can see right here. That's where I'm going to be measuring power. Just to see what kind of voltages we're getting. I got the ground to the ground strap over here. I haven't plugged it in yet, so let me do that right now. You're not gonna hear anything at all. There we go. Partly because, of course, there's no monitor to hear. And partly because, of course, I've removed power from the board. So let me check these pins. I remember some of these over here were 12 or 5. Oh yeah, see, I'm getting nothing at all because I know I'm getting nothing at all. It's this switch here. I wish there was a way to override it. I'm gonna have to hold it in, I believe. Can you guys see that switch? Yeah, it was a switch. Normally, I believe this goes on the back door. I suspect I'm gonna have to hold it in like this to actually get any power to the machine. Let's try it this way. This is gonna be complicated. How am I gonna do this with one hand? I'm still getting nothing at all. Yeah, I am reading nothing. So what we're gonna do is instead verify, let me see if I have that on DC, I do. Let's check this one more time. Yeah, I'm not getting anything. All right, so there could be something else, some other reason why this is not powering up. I'm gonna do a few other checks. First, we gotta see the fuse at the bottom, make sure it's working, and then I'm going to check and see if we're actually getting AC. So give me 1 minute here. Okay, I did another meatball move, of course, like usual. I tested the The fuses, all the fuses checked out okay. You just got to set your meter there on continuity and touch each probe to either side of the fuse to check and see if the fuses work. All the fuses are fine. And then I checked the power brick down below, over there, just to check and see on the other, see if it was getting AC, and it was, 120 volts. And then of course I realized, like a meatball, I had the power switch over here, I had forgotten to turn it on. So, let's go ahead and check this live. Before I turn on the power, I'll unplug this again. Carefully, here we go. Let's leave this guy right here. And what I'm gonna do is just get this thing all set up. I have it on DC volts, this to the ground strap. So it's powered on. There we go, you can hear some humming and all that kind of noise. And the marquee light has come on, which is cool. All right, so let's get this guy over here. And I will test, just in case. I know one of these pins is the 5 volt. Can you guys still see this? Yeah. Let's see this first one here. So it's 11.66, that's the 12 volt line. Second pin is 5.234. So it's giving a healthy voltage, so that's good. Let me turn this off again. All right, now I'm gonna go ahead and plug this thing back in. I kinda just check it, I wanna make sure it's not putting like 5.7 volts or something crazy high like that. It's pretty close to the 5 volts, so. He did say it was playing blind, now we're gonna find out. I got everything plugged in. AC is verified, DC is verified. Fuses are verified. We should hear Stargate once I hit the power switch. Let's give this a try. All right, zero over there. Well, there we go. That is Stargate, all right. Okay, this looks like it's working. So it is playing blind, and I noticed a few things, and I'll take this thing off. And I'll kill the light here. There's an error code meter here which shows zero, so that's looking good. And there's 3 lights on these power bricks here for all the various voltages. Let me turn off this light completely. All 3 LEDs are on. That's for each of the 3 voltages. I think it's like -5, 5, and 12 or something like that. I always forget. So this is indeed playing blind, which is good. All right, so the first thing I'm gonna do right now, just to see if that can actually watch the game playing, I'm going to clean out this monitor area here, and I'm going to get my 19-inch monitor set up inside. Very quickly realizing I'm going to have to make a few mods to the monitor here. There's a couple of problems with it. It doesn't sit as high, I guess, as the standard Williams monitors did. So, I mean, I guess the easy way to see it, maybe you could see it like this, but see the little gap from right there at the top of the bezel to the top of the monitor, the gap. The monitor needs to be basically, I don't know, maybe a half inch higher, something like that. Let's put this back here. So I think I may end up putting a little platform underneath, a half inch piece of wood for this thing to sit on, and that should get it at the right height. So that's simple enough to take care of. The video signal cable is exact same pin out, so this should hook up just fine. The power cable is not. I'm gonna have to make another one. I have Molex connectors and stuff like that. Where is my? So on this Vision Pro that I have, you have this connector here. Let's lower it a little bit. This connector goes into the monitor itself, and then I have these wiring at the end. Right now it's just all snipped. I don't have the right connectors. I'm gonna put a Molex connector here on the end here and change this one. I'll get it to match up on either end, so that way I can get power to the monitor. So, first things first, I gotta take the monitor out. I gotta cut a little piece of wood. I think about a half inch should do. That'll get this monitor to the correct height. Secure that down. Secure this monitor to that. Plug in the video signal and then get the Molex power connectors all squared out. When I restored my Time Pilot, that one came with no back door, and I had a long piece of wood like this one, a pretty long one I'd cut and used it to make the back door. This is the remnants of that piece. And I think that'll be actually a pretty good size as a platform. Now, it may be a little too thick, as a monitor platform, I mean. It may raise it a little too high, I don't know. I'm gonna cut it to size and shove it in there underneath the monitor, so there's a monitor area. So that piece of wood, I just gotta trim it to slide under there as a platform, just to raise this monitor up a little bit more. Maybe too high, I don't know, but I'm gonna give it a shot. If it is too high, I'll have to go find a quarter inch or some other piece, but I'm gonna trim this guy, fit it in there, and dry fit it all, and and see if that'll get the monitor the correct height. Well, it turns out by some cosmic fluke, the width is exactly right for these pieces to slide right on in. Obviously the length, I gotta cut the size, but I figured let me slide in and see if the height is even correct. And sure enough, it's perfect. I check, you look at the monitor from the front to see if there's any gap from the monitor to the bezel, and there's none. So this piece will work perfectly. So right now what I gotta do is take this all back out again, measure out how deep I need to make this. This guy doesn't need to be very deep because just to support the monitor. So I'll probably end up cutting it probably somewhere along here. Snip that and give the place for monitor to sit. So we'll have a nice new monitor platform to work on. So I'm gonna do that right now. So I still have my joust machine here, fortunately this location. And since it's similar to Stargate, I decided to take off the back and take a look at the monitor setup. And yeah, sure enough, it looks like when they harvested the monitor from my Stargate, here's the monitor, and it looks like it actually does come with a piece of wood. I forgot how this thing is laid out. They have a bolt there, and they have a bolt there, and that holds this wooden platform inside. You take those two bolts out, and the monitor with that piece of wood all slide out. And in my Stargate, both the monitor and that wood are missing, which is why the piece of wood I put in there slides in almost perfect. Looks to be just the right size. So you can see how far the wood goes. I'm going to cut it that exact same length. I'm going to get it to match up this one, basically. All right, I got my piece of wood in place. So it was as simple as just measuring and cutting it. On my joust, it came to about here, so I did the same thing. Cut the piece, slid it in, and I got two bolts in here. Now, the way I did to figure out how these bolts match up to the holes below is I simply slid this piece of wood in place. I took these bolts. I used a black marker on the back end, just like put a thick coat of black on them. I put them through from the bottom till they touched the wood on the other side, and they effectively made two little marks where I needed to drill holes. So I drilled the holes there, put my bolts and washers through here. There's a washer and a nut on the other side to hold this in place. Now, it does have T-nuts, and normally the bolt would screw it into the T-nut. I cannot find in my stash a bolt that was just quite the right size. So I use these, which are a little bit thinner, so they go through, but they're bolted on both sides. So it's not going to go anywhere. That's going to be good enough. Now what I got to do is just plop the monitor on top here, figure out its positioning, and drill it down. It'll be probably four holes to hold that into place. The monitor tray is complete. So this is how it is on my joust as well. You got this piece of wood down here below it, and it's going to screw in on here and two on the other side as well. And you pretty much take that whole thing and slide it in, which is what I'm going to do right now. Just get the camera off to the side somewhere. That's probably okay there. Just got to get the various straps and stuff out of the way. Hopefully this will stay out of the way. So just going to grab it. Slide it on in. Fortunately, the cabinet wants to slide away too. And there we go. And now I just gotta put in. There we go, that's in place. Now I gotta put in the two bolts on the end here. Incidentally, before I forget, I realized what the heck this was for. Of course, after looking at my joust, it reminded me. There's normally a little switch here. It's a switch that was down below as well. I thought that's what this one was, but they just took it out. So a little switch that when you take out the back door, the switch comes out and it won't let you turn on the game. On this particular machine, they just removed it, snipped the wires, and pretty much short-circuited it to always be on, which I'm fine with. I'm going to leave this here. I'll just snip it and get it. Not snip it, but I'll pin it up here out of the way. I won't bother putting this back because I don't really care. Anyway. Now I'm going to get these two bolts secured into place to complete the monitor tray area. The various parts of the monitor now are in place. So I've connected, I've secured it on here. It's got the two bolts that hold the tray here and here. You can see it's got four screws, one there, one at the end, one there, one at the end. So the monitor's going nowhere. And in case you're curious how it looks from the front, fits in pretty nicely. Yeah, I still haven't cleaned the front. That's all filthy. I'm just kind of dealing with the monitor right now. But coming back here, this is the signal cable, which I connected there. This was the little connector for the control board, which I ended up screwing down there. So that way you can make the adjustments from the front. You just open the coin door and you can do all your adjustments there. This is the grounding cable, goes to the grounding thing here. So the last thing I have is power. The power cable on this guy is right there, has its own kind of non-standard connector, and it comes to these two cables, and the power connector from the game is this. So naturally that doesn't fit to that. So I'm going to snip this. I have Molex connectors upstairs, 2-pin. So I'm going to make a connector to hook this and this together. And that'll complete The monitor, I mean, the monitor setup, aside from powering it on and making sure it works, but I'm going to go take care of this right now. The last of the cabling is done. So you can see here the power cable, the one that goes to the monitor, has this type of Molex connector. And then the one from the cabinet has this. So at that point, it's just a matter of making the connection. So let's see, I want to just leave that, I guess, down there out of the way. Everything is connected. In theory now, we plug this in and power it on, we're going to get visuals. So, let's find out what happens. So I'm going to, I'll leave this open, I guess. What I'll do is the power is off on the machine, so I can safely plug it in without anything happening. All right, that's in. Why didn't I come around here? All toolboxes and... You're wondering what's in the way. Every time I have to look for nuts and bolts, I gotta go through all that stuff. But anyway, let's get this over here. And in fact, we don't need this light. We don't need any light at all. So I'm gonna hit power. Let's just see if there's any fire, sparks, or explosions. Okay, I hear the monitor going on. It makes that trademark high-pitched whine. Hey, here we go. And we have Stargate. Now I gotta make some adjustments to the monitor and it's okay. This monitor always had something. I noticed that even when I was having it on my time pile, you see this noise? That goes away after about an hour, after about 5-10 minutes. I'm not sure what it is. It just does it at first, but anyway, at least we have visuals. Now, I have my little control board down there so I can make some adjustments, but oh, there we go. That's pretty much what I wanted to see. I wanted to see the game working. Sweet. No buttons or control panel yet. I think every time you press this, yeah, there we go. It changes the... Yeah, one of them, reverse, gives you the secrets. Hyperspace shows the scores. Which button, I remember it did something, but... Cool. So we have monitor. And I'm going to adjust it and size it to fit the game a little better because it's a little bit off and I can see the screen value is a little high and stuff like that. No big deal. So actually next I was thinking of doing the coin door. Let me just turn the lights one more time. Now the coin doors came with the unit. Take this off here. And it didn't have any bolts or nothing like that. But if you remember from my... Time Pilot Restore, these are the bolts I used to mount the monitor in, and I had a whole bunch of spare bolts I used, I took off from the lock bar that I didn't need. I think these should fit both parts of the coin doors, the bucket area and the coin door area. So to start with, I'm going to first deal with this guy, pretty much just get it painted, get some of those bolts painted and get that plugged in, just to have that ready to go, and I think I'm going to do that one too. So it's easy enough to round out the front. I mean, the front is not, aside from cleaning, there isn't really much else to do on it. And once those two coin door parts are in, the front is essentially complete. Aside from cleaning. Well, I guess I gotta resecure this marquee bracket, but hey, whatever, not a big deal. All right, cool. So I'm gonna get busy looking at these guys right here. As per usual, I've taken the coin door apart. So those are gonna be rinsed, dried off, and then I got the spray can right there. I just give them a nice little coat of paint and get them onto the door. Meantime, I've just left Stargate running just to make sure everything is working okay. It's having no problems. It's been running here for, I don't know, half hour or something like that. Letting it play along in its merry way. Monitor looks actually pretty darn good. Oh, excuse me. One thing I'm cleaning up these old cabinets, they kick up a lot of dust, which makes me sneeze like crazy. Let me kill the lights here. Get a better idea. I've sized the monitor and fit it better to the screen. Very nice looking monitor. It's working out real good. There we go. But in the meantime, I'm going to focus on getting these guys done. Right down here. Let me get the light on one more time. Now, I'm having perhaps a slight change of heart. Not a change of heart, but I'm going to think this through just a little bit more. Turn this on. So after I get the coin doors on, it pretty much is just going to need the joystick here. And the missing buttons, of course, and then it'll be playable. Now, I have both a Stargate and a Defender. I don't need both. So, Yeah, you can see a machine. There's a machine on the right. That's a sneak peek of another machine I just got, but I'll be doing a video of that one later. But anyway, back to the Stargate. I don't need both a Stargate and a Defender. So I think what I'm going to do, before I even touch on the sides and go that far, I'm going to get this machine all together and looking pretty nice. The front is pretty clean now. I got to get that joystick on and get those coin doors on, and that'll be nice. And then I got to put the back door on. Once the coin doors, joystick, and the back door are on, the game is basically complete and works fine. I mean, it would need new side art, but other than that, it's good to go. So what I'm going to do first, I think, before I even touch the side art, is get the game all together and working, and then just spend some time playing it and decide which one I'm going to keep, Stargate or Defender. If I'm going to keep Stargate, then I will do the sides. If I'm going to keep Defender, then actually I'm not going to do the sides. I'm going to leave it like this, and I'll probably just sell it off this way to another collector. So I think that's going to be the current plan. So right now I'm going to continue on. I know the joystick has been shipped. That joystick is going to go right over there. That's on the way. And the coin doors I'm going to finish up today. So at least that'll be done. And then I got to go buy a piece of, figure out what to do for the back door, or buy a piece of wood for that. In the process of reassembling the coin door, mercifully the Williams coin doors are super simple to take apart. It's got three nuts. One, two, three. You take those off, all the coin mech part comes off. You can spray paint this, reassemble it. So I've reattached the coin mech parts on. Just got to get the door onto here and get this stuff bolted onto the cabinet. Just wrapped up a whole bunch of stuff. So as you can see, I got both of the coin doors on, which is pretty cool. So that kind of completes the look in the front. And we'll come around back. Every wire is kind of serving a purpose now. There's nothing just dangling unconnected. So you can see that right there. There was a little switch. I was just kind of flopping around down here when we were looking at it. I wasn't sure what it was for. That's where it goes. It basically, when the coin door opens and closes, it triggers that switch, I guess, so they can keep track of that. People coming and going in the coin door. Right? But that's set up there. I got the ground strap connected right there. Coin door is all in place, and of course I connected the coin door to that little strap there. Can't remember if I showed it or not, but the monitor board I kind of secured over there. Everything else is looking good. The monitor we showed as well. Oh yeah! One thing I did discover. Remember the numbers when we were looking at them here? And this one, the number, let me lower the light here a bit. The numbers on all the boards here are 560147, and all the internal boards are numbers matching. I was kind of hoping to find some way to tie that to the cabinet, and I couldn't, even though I looked around, I couldn't find any number. Well, as I was putting on the coin doors, I saw by chance right over there. It's tough to make out, but that says 560147. You guys can see that. So this is a complete numbers matching Stargate cabinet. I have no idea what the odds are of that, but there it is. The monitor, of course, is not original because that was jacked, but I had to put one in there. But the rest of it is all original, which is fabulous. I put my little typical twist locks here. Of course, like usual, let's lock that. And I changed out the bulbs naturally to incandescent. Turn it off here. You can see, not incandescent. It comes with incandescents. I put the LED 5-volt bulbs in there, and all this coin door stuff is in place. I'll have to set the game to free play and all that fun stuff. So it's looking good. Let me close up the back here. It's got those two clamps you got to put on. Let me just reach in carefully here. Don't not want to get shocked. There we go. So clearly from the back, I still do not have a back door. I gotta buy some wood. Well, I did buy some wood to fix that. It's over there. I'm not sure if that wood is the right one or not. This you'll notice from TimePilot, I'm kind of overlapping videos here. Everything is waiting on parts, so I'm doing things as I get them. So it's getting a little bit confusing with all these games. But anyway, this game technically is almost there. Let me turn off the lights. I just got my camera light on now, but let's turn that off so you can see how good the screen looks. That is a fine looking screen. It takes a few minutes to warm up. When this screen, for whatever reason, first turn it on, it kind of shimmers a little bit. I don't know what's up with it, but after about 5 minutes, it's perfectly solid and no burn-in as well. This looks good. This is a good looking game of Stargate. It's funny, I'm sitting in a pitch black and my little Sony A7S has no problem filming it. What a crazy camera. So let me turn on some light. We'll give it some help. Actually, I'll give it the garage lights back on. The garage is a bit of a mess. I was doing some sawing in here. God, it's just a total mess. But so, I mean, technically, this game can be brought inside, and I mean, it's clean. Everything else that's left, I could probably do inside. I mean, it's missing a couple of buttons, which are simple enough on the joystick. I'm hoping I'm going to get these this week, so I'm waiting on that. And I got to fabricate a back door over here. There still is that to do. Optional, and then I guess optionally is painting this back and doing the sides. You know, I decided I was going to wait and see if, I mean, if I'm going to keep this game, because I do have Defender already, so I'm not 100% sure if I'm going to keep both. If I'm going to keep both games, then I will probably do the sides. Well, I mean, this side looks great. It's the other side, unfortunately, that is somewhat more sad. There's an argument to be made to just leave it stock. I mean, because it's really bad down there. Up top, not too bad. I'm going back and forth now, maybe just keeping it original, because it isn't that bad. I don't know. In any case, I got options. So I just got to figure out a back door, and then I got to wait for the joystick, and that's about it. This game is really coming together pretty quick, fortunately. So I'm going to put this aside, I guess. I'm probably going to hop back to one of my other projects, since I'm going to be waiting on the joysticks. I have brought Stargate inside, because, I mean, most everything is done. There's a couple other things I've done, I mean, aside from cleaning it up, of course. I did get a piece of wood for the back here, just from Home Depot when I cut it. Now, to be honest, I didn't quite buy the right piece of wood. It's not quite thick enough. I had read online and there was a quarter inch thickness, and that doesn't seem to be the case. It might need to be a 3/8, I don't know. But Home Depot has two types like this that already have the groove on them, so it'll fit right down there. You don't even need to router it. One was this one, which I got, was about a quarter inch, and I think they had another one that was 3/8 inch. I should have got the thicker one, I didn't. I've put this one on just because that's what I have, but I may end up replacing it to get the proper thickness one, because it isn't quite right, but I don't know. It may not matter, but it may end up bugging me over time. The missing buttons here I ended up installing. It was missing the two buttons here, player one, player two. I actually had these leaf style buttons because I had two for my junior pack dedicated I was going to use. I don't know if you guys remember that. There's the junior pack dedicated. Believe it or not, it's going on 3 months. It's still waiting on the top marquee, the bezel, and the CPO. I'm telling you, it definitely takes some patience in this hobby if you want to wait for stuff. It's still waiting on them, and I have no idea when I'm going to get them, to be honest. So, rather than let those two buttons just sit there on the shelf, I went ahead and put them in here. So the control panel buttons are complete. What's still missing is the joystick, as you can see here, and I did just get that in the mail. So this is it. I got it from a member on Clav, and it's the correct joystick, but it's been modified with, I believe, what's called Zero Play mod. It makes it, I mean, compared to my Defender, this is a much more rigid joystick. There's no wiggle at all, so I can kind of see why these pros maybe like it, but I got to get that installed in there. And aside from that, there is only one thing which, I'm not going to lie, I'm a little torn on at the moment, and it's the side art. You'll notice I brought it inside and haven't done anything. I'm very much having second thoughts on doing anything with the side art. I mean, you know, this thing is like a numbers matching Stargate. Everything inside is all matched up. Even the cabinet matches up. And while this side of the side art does look kind of bad, let me do a little quick rotation here. Pop the camera a little bit. Take the camera for a ride. My problem is this side just looks good. I mean, there's not much to it, and it's original, and it's, I don't know, I'm kind of torn about touching it at all. Half of me is thinking just leave it as a survivor. Yeah, I know the bottom is kind of chewed up on both sides. And yep, the other side is rough, at least down below. But I don't know, am I crazy for wanting to leave it this way? I'm having second thoughts on touching it. I'm kind of just thinking of leaving it be as a survivor. I don't know, man. And you can kind of tell that it's original. Let me hold this by hand here. Side art. Because, you know, when you see side art is redone, it always tends to look a little more perfect and perfectly smooth edges. And I mentioned it on my joust. They are never perfectly smooth. I mean, I wonder if this will come out on camera here. But let's pick an edge here. It's a little bit sharper over here. And look at this one. This one has a bunch of overspray. This one has a bunch of overspray. That has a lot of overspray. You know, it kind of, it's all different. The whole thing looks a little fuzzy, and again, I don't know how well this comes out on camera, but these are not super sharp edges all the time. You have an edge here which is relatively clean, but then right up here you have one that has overspray. Just because in the factory, at least as I was told, sometimes the stencil was just a piece of tin thrown over and, you know, was hit with paint. And the tin wouldn't always sit firmly onto the cabinet. So sometimes, like here, you got a little more overspray, sometimes here a little less. So, man, I don't know. I have a guy who can come and touch this all up and do all that work. I mean, there's two options. One is the re-stenciling and one is the touching up. I decided I just don't want to re-stencil it. Not just because I'm not good at re-stenciling, but re-stenciling means sanding down this side and prep it, you know, and primering it and doing all that stuff. I just don't want to lose this side. I mean, this side is too good condition and too original. I just don't want to mess with it. So I do not want to go the stenciling route. So the option is touching up. And I don't know. You guys can tell me if I'm crazy or not. I think I'm going to leave it this way. I know the other side's more rough. But heck, I can set this up in a lineup where this is the side that's visible or something like that and keep it as a complete survivor. So for the moment, with Stargate, at least currently my plan is to not actually do anything on the side. Or I think I'm just going to leave it. Everything is clean, which means all that remains is to install that joystick on it. And then I may correct the back door. I don't know if I'm lazy, not too lazy. I'll go to Home Depot, get a thicker piece and repaint it. I don't know if I'll do that or not, but other than that, once the joystick is in, this guy is ready to go, ready to play. So I'm going to get busy getting that joystick installed. The joystick is now on. So these are a little bit tricky to install. Actually, in fact, let me actually open the control panel here. Like usual, these control panels, you can kind of reach inside here. Get at the little clips. Hold the control panel in place. Make sure you keep like a hand on the control panel so it doesn't come swinging over and bonk you in the head. Got that little chain on here. So probably easiest to hand hold this. Oops, I hit start by accident. So you'll be hearing the sounds of Stargate in the background. Well, actually, while I'm in here, you can see how I installed the little buttons here. These are the kind of called leaf switch buttons, because they don't have a micro switch on the end. They actually hit a little leaf switch, which is right there. You can see there's just a nut. You pretty much put the button through and screw the nut on it, and that's it. I mean, that's why I didn't kind of show it before. It's pretty trivial. The joystick, though, is a little bit more involved. So, like most joysticks, you have to take the stick out or the shaft out before you can kind of put it into the control panel. And most of them is pretty easy because the C-clip that holds this in place is easily accessible. You pop that off, slide this through, pop it back on, piece of cake. Not so with these crazy joysticks. They are a bit of a pain in the ass, to be honest. So, as you can see, hopefully you can see, but down in there, behind this piece of metal, is where the C-clip is that holds the shaft in place. So the only way I found to get that off is, and we'll see how visible this is, but you can see there's two screws on the side. There's one there and one there, and the other side is two as well. What I did, I loosened this one, or took out this one, I should say, and took out the corresponding top one on the other side, and I just loosened the bottom screw. That let me take this whole middle bracket and kind of tilt it outwards and let me have access to that C-clip. So that way I was able to take off the C-clip, assemble this all here, put the C-clip back, put this back down, and put the screws back in. And then after that, it's pretty easy. It's just four screws. There's two here screwed into the wooden panel. But it's a little bit trickier to install these, but that's the basic process. So this is a very, very stiff joystick, I have to say. My Defender has the typical stock one. This is at zero play, and there's not as much play. It's very stiff. I'm not going to say it's better than the stock one, to be honest. I mean, it's just different. But, I mean, I'm not a Defender or Stargate Pro by any stretch of the imagination. So, I'm more amateur player. So, for me, either or is fine. But it's interesting to feel the difference. So, anyway, this is all in place. This chain, by the way, hooks up to that thing there just to make sure it won't bonk you on the head. So, I'll put that back on as a little safety. So, let me get this guy back on here. There we go. Now we can reassemble this. I will put the chain. Yeah, I keep hitting these player start buttons, and we keep hearing the sounds of Stargate. That's one. And that's two. All right. And that is it. Actually, now I'm not going to really need the light. I'm actually not even going to need this light. Because this restoration is now a wrap. It is done. All right. Well, you know, I'll keep the hallway light on for now while I just kind of chat about it. But yeah, so like most of my restorations, I tend to like change my mind along the way. It's just kind of the nature of the beast.
And I was originally contemplating doing the stenciling thing, the touching up thing. I've absolutely ruled out stenciling. That is something I will not do. And I'm not even going to touch it up right now. I'm going to just leave it be. And that is primarily because of this. Like I talked about, this art.
I'm just happy with it as is. I can't bear to mess with it. You know, I'm not sure if I'm going to keep this game or not because they do have Defender already. And I don't think I need both games. But I'll leave it for the next owner to decide if I do sell this. For me, I decided this will be fine. The other side's not quite as good, but that's okay. If I do keep it in a lineup, I'll just put it somewhere where this side is visible. Let's flip this guy right this way. All complete.
It's always nice to see the games when they're back up and running. This poor guy had was kind of stripped for parts. The joystick was taken, buttons were taken, the monitor was yanked, the monitor stand was yanked, didn't even have a back door. Fortunately, got lucky on this one, and I guess everything not only worked, but was numbers matching and had some mods in it. The lithium ion battery mod is cool. Well, I should say the battery cell mod is cool. That's really what it is. And the 5-volt RAM mod is cool because it's two things I always do regardless. And it's been running great. Looking pretty good. I would say the only issue I had, this particular monitor is an old one I had lying around. It takes about 5 or so minutes to warm up. It has a little fuzziness on it. I've deduced that seems to be because of the flyback. If you just touch the screen knob a little bit, it clears up. Or if you just leave it for 5-10 minutes, it all goes away. And then it's a rock solid image. But it is something I noticed. But other than that, looks good, plays good. We have Stargate. Let's get a nice side shot of it here. Good looking game. Let me get the light here. Actually, we'll get a beauty shot. There we go. Let's light up that side art. There we go. Pretty good. So, you know, the before and after is not too dramatic on this one just because it was missing parts. It was a pretty easy restore, hence the one part. Well, I'm glad it's done. So I'm going to keep keeping it for now, playing it a bunch, and then deciding which one stays, Defender or Stargate. I'm pretty sure Defender will be the one that stays. I have more nostalgia, you know, connection with that one. But I'll keep this one for a while at least and have fun with it. So I guess what we should do now is have a game. May as well. I'm terrible at this game, but what the hell. Let's just videotape myself having a game and embarrassing myself. Okay, I got the camera all set up. It's kind of tough to find a shot that didn't have reflections because it's kind of midday right now and light's pouring in from everywhere. But this ought to work. Okay, it'll be a little tight for me, but I'll just keep my feet all contained. So here we go with Stargate, 1981 Williams. So I was always a huge fan of Williams games. Some of their games I'm pretty good at, like Joust. Some of the games I'm very good at, like Robotron. Stargate is neither. I am terrible at this game. I'm a little bit better at Defender. I can get around, you know, 90,000 maybe on Defender. On this game, I pretty much top out at about 50. Once you get to that dogfight wave, I basically don't know what the hell to do, and it's game over. But we'll give it a try. We'll see if we can get past that wave 5. I suppose everyone has their strategies. I just kind of go for the landers. I kind of cruise the ground and make sure the landers are gone before I do anything else. Unless it's like low-hanging fruit. Whoops, sorry, human there. Sorry, dude. This game, unlike Defender, will tell you when all the landers are destroyed, which is super useful. Bunched up together, aren't you? See, all landers destroyed. So at least I know that part is done. I don't have to worry about ending up in the space. I do have to worry about dying. But at least I know the humans are going to be okay. What is left here? Oh, there he is. Probably one of these spinny guys. Mutants are not too bad. Those spinny guys are a pain. You have to learn the strafe thing, but I could never quite fire fast enough. Except when it comes to killing humans, then somehow I'm able to fire perfectly fast. But I can never quite get the speed down. Let's fizzle out of here. Man. This one is tough. Oh, landers are this way. Okay, all landers destroyed. Looks like I could use. See that I just miss on the strafe, which makes it. I Let's bomb it. This is a complete waste of a bomb, but... Hey, that strafing attack worked. Where are you, fire guy? Hey, there we go. I don't know, do I need to get a looser button or something, or I'm just getting old and can't hit it very quickly? I don't know. But it's a problem in this game if you can't strafe fast. It's kind of a really important tactic. Whoa. Humanoids remaining too. Oh, that's great. And I'll leave that guy. Well, at least, why don't I hold on to this guy? At least until the landers are gone. Because I think I'm holding the last human, actually. Are any of the landers? Yeah, there's one more. Somewhere right here, I think. Yep, all landers are destroyed. Now I can put that guy down. Hit the little pixel guy. Alright, attack wave 4. Oh, see, these are the waves that kill me. I don't have a strategy for these waves because they just throw everything at you. What if I try to kick him? Oh, okay, that didn't work. Just get away. I don't have any smart bombs. Okay, there's a couple coming alone. Can handle them. Oh, whoa, someone died there. Oh, gosh. Well, I'm almost at a free guy, which will give me a smart bomb, which will definitely help. There we go. So, why don't I get all those guys? Okay, there's not too much left over there. Looks like there's a couple of these bullet guys here. Alright. Starfleet. I mean, honestly, that's the reason I don't like this game better than Defender. It probably is better. It has a lot less slowdown. I mean, Defender really crawls sometimes. Oh, no smart bombs. I'm hitting the smart bomb. Defender just crawls to a halt. It goes really slow. Whereas this game is, you know, the enemies will still disappear or do stuff like that when there's too much of them on screen. But the slowdown is nowhere near as bad. Focus on the landers, don't get distracted. I'm gonna throw it back there. Probably the last lander right there. Yeah, all landers destroyed. Okay, I could focus on cleaning house here. Oh, no smart. I have tons of Inviso. I always forget about Inviso. No wonder I'm terrible at this game. Forget. You can turn invisible in this game. Kind of important. I had smart bomb instead of Inviso there. Bombers are annoying. 58,550. I mean, that's my typical score on this game. I'm not very good at it. I'm really not. I was watching a guy on YouTube play this game while just chatting at the same time with the 500,000 points. He made it look like a cakewalk, but for me, that's my best score. So anyway, that right there is Stargate. Will I keep it or will I not keep it? I suspect Defender will be the one I keep. That one I have a little bit more nostalgia value to. You know, it's interesting when you compare these games, Defender and Stargate, are very much like Millipede and Centipede, where, you know, Millipede each added an extra element and kind of stepped up the frenzy. So, like, Millipede added DDT, Stargate added Inviso. You know, Millipede just throws more at you compared to Centipede, and Stargate throws more at you compared to Defender. So, although it's weird because with Millipede and Centipede, I like Millipede better. I mean, I have a Millipede. To me, that's easily the better game. I think it's one of the best games ever made. With Stargate and Defender, I'm not so sure. I mean, I think I prefer Defender, even though it kind of slows down and bogs down a bit. Although this game is just great eye candy, and it's just, you know, a very nice example of 80s gaming. Looks pretty good, too. Let's get some light on it. A little bit of light. And there it is. There's my Stargate all complete. We're all done. Wrap up another restoration. Why don't we hop on upstairs to the office?
And with that, another restore comes to an end. Well, I mean, this time it wasn't really so much a restore as so much as finding the pieces and putting them back together. When I got the cabinet, I was told it did work. It was just missing stuff. The monitor had been harvested. Monitor tray was gone. Back door was gone. Coin doors were all disconnected, but they were part of the package. You know, it was things like that. Or just things were missing. The buttons were missing. The joystick wasn't there. So I just had to locate these things. It turned out I had most of the stuff in my stock. I did have a monitor, spare 19-inch, my last one, so I went into that game. Had, you know, it was pretty basic stuff, a piece of wood from Home Depot to make the back door. I had a couple of buttons, which was great, put it in there. The joystick was a little trickier. Those Defender joysticks or Stargate 2-way joysticks are tough to find and not cheap. That was $75 just for that refurbished joystick. Although, it was upgraded to the, what they call the Zero Play kit. I've been calling it the Zero Play kit all this time. I hope there's the right name for it, but it makes it very stiff. It's definitely a different feel compared to the stock Defender one. I'm used to the stock one. This one, who knows, if I played with this one enough, the stock one may just feel so loose and unusable to me. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. But anyway, got all the pieces together. And I got lucky in the sense that there was some mods already in place. It already had the 5-volt battery mod, which is cool. It already had the old AA battery holder removed and, you know, little button battery put in. So it was good to go. And I guess the good fortune was it was numbers matching, which to me is always really, really cool. It's so rare to find something numbers matching, you know, especially with the Williams games, because a lot of the parts, the boards are shareable between games, so they tend to come and go as things break. So yeah, the side art, you know, I don't know, do you think I'm crazy for leaving it that way? It's mostly because of that left side art was so well intact. I just didn't want to mess with it. I just left it. I know the right side was a little more rough, but I'm just leaving it. You know, I'm still not 100% sure if I'll keep this cabinet. If I sell it off to them, someone else, or trade it off, they can do what they like with it. It'll be up to them. If I end up keeping it, who knows, maybe in the future I'll be like, hey, I'll get the thing touched up, make it look better. But for right now, I'm actually happy with it the way it is. I think it looks good. It certainly plays well. Monitor looks great. It's a good game. Although, honestly, I think I still prefer Defender better, to be honest. As cool as Stargate is, you know, I like that it has no slowdown and all that. I hate those every 5 waves you get those dogfight waves. It just seems kind of cheesy, like there was a way for them to like kill off the player. I don't know. I'm not a big fan of that part, but otherwise it's a pretty cool game. So we'll wrap that up. Stargate is done. On to the next one. I've got, well, you probably saw what the next one will be. It kind of poked its way into this video here and there because it was sitting in my garage. But I'm going to start up with that one. As we're talking right now, I still haven't even finished the Time Pilot. It's still waiting on a couple of things. And believe my dedicated Junior Pac-Man video, the conversion one had gotten finished. I never finished the dedicated one. 3 months still waiting for parts on that one. So I still have those two in the pipe, but I suspect those will just keep waiting on parts. And I'll start on that other new game that you guys kind of already saw down in the garage. But that'll be the next video, most likely. So thanks again for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed the video. We'll catch you all next time. Bye-bye.